Good morning, everyone. Thank you for coming in and joining us today. Welcome to the live in-person and live Zoom worship service of the Unitarian Universalist Church of Riverside. Our doors are open and we will continue live streaming and posting these services on our YouTube channel for our virtual attendees. I'm Grace Preuss, a member of the worship committee, and I will be one of your worship associates today. Dinah Rowe, our church treasurer, will be another member that you will hear from today. We welcome you to join us this morning with an open mind and an open heart, and with muted electronic devices, please. We welcome you to this growing, journeying community. We welcome all of you to our service, whether it's your first time in worship with us or your 100th time. We hope that you'll find here questions that stretch you, perspectives that inspire you, and inclusive values that challenge you to join us in loving boldly, living justly, and thinking freely. Although our doors are open, the pandemic is not over. So while we are here, please keep your masks on and socially distance. We can speak in normal tones, but singing or chanting creates an increased risk of airborne exposure. So we ask you to refrain for the time being. We invite those of you in the sanctuary to sit back and enjoy listening. For those of you at home, please sing your hearts out. And now I invite you to sit back and take a slow, deep breath as we move into the worship hour. For our call to worship, you are welcome to read with me the mission statement of our church. Our mission is to foster a diverse religious community that celebrates life, affirms the individual, encourages spiritual growth and open thought, and works to advance social justice and environmental sustainability. Alec Peck has been a member of our church community for the past year and is the chair of our worship committee and also helps to organize the musical elements for our services. Alec has been a practicing UU for 23 years and has a deep passion for the intellectual and spiritual challenges of exploring the six sources of our living tradition. He was raised in a UU church chosen by his father, raised Quaker, and mother, raised Jewish, though both humanist in practice. Alec has studied natural science at Creighton University, a Jesuit institution, is now completing his PhD at UC Riverside. Alec grew up watching Star Trek, The Next Generation, and Voyager, and other iconic sci-fi media which reflect human values in a unique way. In 1966, Gene Roddenberry's vision of the future came to life in the Western in-space Star Trek. Roddenberry showed us an optimistic future. Humanity's internal problems, including racism, poverty, and violence, have been solved, and the morality of humans is tested in the wilderness of space. Starfleet and the Starfleet officers in the series serve as moral paragons in a future where humanity has become the best it can be. The ideals of Star Trek are built on the inherent rights of all sentient beings, protection of those who are vulnerable, and the power of societal connection and diplomacy. Star Trek's version of the future speaks directly to the UU vision for ourselves and our society. And the world of Star Trek is a view into a future dedicated to UU morality. We have two lightings of sacred flames. The first is the Occupied Indigenous Peoples Remembrance Candle. The second is the lighting of our own chalice, the symbol of our faith. We walk upon the traditional territories of diverse and sovereign peoples, the original people of this land, who continue to cry out for justice and self-determination. This spot we occupied was first the sacred space of several groups of California Indians, including the Kawiya, the Cupeño, and the Serrano. We, the Universalist Unitarian Church of Riverside, light this sacred flame as the stewards of this sacred and holy place. We are blessed with a space and opportunity to strive to live out our common principles, to bring justice, equity, and compassion into our daily lives, to resist all that threatens the earth and her people, and to be part of a world community with peace, liberty, and justice for all. Let these thoughts carry us forth as we journey and worship together. Thank you, Bill. And now I'd like to invite Alec up to the pulpit to read The Chalice Lighting, A Fire in the Universe by Sean Trapp.
Thank you, Grace. Fire in the Universe by Sean Trapp. Our chalice reminds us that the fire within ourselves is the same fire that illuminates the universe. It is our reminder that all is connected, even though the space of the void is vast, and our experience here is but a blip in the cosmic timeline. This flame is our promise that in our smallness and our short time on Earth, that we live intently and deeply, with love for one another, with honesty and integrity, to be guided by rational thought and critical thinking, and with a sense of shared responsibility. For as the late astronomer Carl Sagan reminds us, this pale blue dot is the only home we've ever known. Thank you, Bill. Our opening hymn this morning is hymn number 121, We'll Build a Land. For those in the sanctuary, please sit back and enjoy the hymn, but please do not sing along.
We'll build a land where we
greeting our guests. We have a tradition here at UUCR. We like to welcome those who are visitors or perhaps returning after some time away. Please, if you are willing and able, stand and tell us your name, where you are from, and how you found out about this place. I think today we have a lot of our regular members. Is there anyone out there in the audience who would like to introduce themselves and how they found our church? We have someone in the back.
Hi, my name is Jimmy, and I just happened to come across it just walking by, and I think that hanging the banner outside is very prominent and allows individuals to be more aware of the fact that the church here is affirming and open. And so the first thing that caught my eye was the banner that's hanging outside. And so ran into Avery, and so one thing led to another, and I'm here today, and so I'm really thankful. So thank you for having me.
Welcome, Jimmy. We're glad you're here. For new guests, our visitor's book is in the parish hall, so please sign it before you leave so that we know you are here and can let you know about upcoming events. For those online, the best way to get added to the mailing list is to email the church office at admin@uuchurchofriverside.org. Adam, is there anyone online who'd like to introduce themselves? Oh, okay. So, during the service, we will mention several websites, email addresses, and phone numbers. At the end of the service, we will leave up a slide with all this information, and it is also available on our website. Chat time provides an opportunity to spend an hour talking among ourselves, usually beginning with the service and leading on to various topics. We have decided that chat time will begin 20 minutes after the end of the service to give people time to mingle. To participate in person, the location will be determined depending on number of participants and safety per pandemic regulations. We have a few additional announcements today. We'd like to remind all of you that our Sunday services will resume the regular starting time of 10 a.m. beginning in September, the first week in September. So next week, we will be starting our services at 10 o'clock. I've also been informed by Avery that we need some help taking down the canopy tent that's on the side of the church that's covering the lawn today. Could we get some volunteers to help out with that after the service? Thank you. For details, please see Avery. Sorry? Okay. And Dinah has just informed us that next Sunday, September 5th, I believe it is the first Sunday lunch here at the church. So everyone is welcome to that. Oh, and the theme is salads. Very healthy. Okay. Our hymn now is Spirit of Life. If you are in the sanctuary, I invite you to sit back, close your eyes, and enjoy.
Thank you. Good morning. This portion of our service is how we support our church and our community. There are many ways you can do this. You can send a check into the church office. The address will be shown. There's a QR code on the order of service that you can use that. And also on the church website, you can use the QR code to donate to the church. We have Staters cards available. The Staters gives our church a rebate for all the cards that are purchased. And now we have $100 Amazon cards we will have each Sunday along with our Staters cards. So if you want any either of those, see me. We're also contributing to our little free pantry we have outside here. So if you bring staple goods, staple items, things that can be easily used and opened, and either put it in the free pantry or there's a bin in the parish hall, you can put those in there at the same time. Would our ushers come forward, please? Thank you.
Thank you for your contributions. Now we will listen to From You I Receive. And now I'd like to invite our speaker today, Alec Peck, to come up to the pulpit and give the meditation and the sermon Lessons from Star Trek.
Our prayer today is by Elizabeth Mount. Come into this place. Bring all that you hold with you, though your heart may be heavily burdened, whether you be on the brink of tears or burn with unquenchable rage, this community can hold you and your strongest emotions. Yes, even the messy ones are welcome here. Come in if you sing just a little bit too loud, if you hold still as statues and just breathe it in, if you sway to the music moving your soul, you are welcome. Come in and say amen when the spirit moves you. Tell that preacher to preach. Preach, yes, that's right, tell us. Or close your eyes and quietly let your mind float free on the blessed words. Come into this place with every piece of yourself gathered up, and let us be the church incarnate. Let us bring forth the spirit of all that we love by the words of our mouths and the doing of our hands. And as we make sacred this time together, let us now pause for a moment of silence. looks familiar. I'd like you all to imagine a world where different peoples of all possible kinds are able to exchange ideas and cultures and share in the vast wonders of the galaxy. Imagine a world where the worth of every single person is so unquestioned that even the idea of racial prejudice seems alien. Imagine a world where people are free to pursue their passions because they are unconstrained by monetary needs or by access to resources. I think it is possible for humanity to reach this kind of true post-scarcity society where food is always convenient to get and basically free to acquire, where people are able to contribute to something that's much bigger than themselves and they're able to act for the greater good and be part of something beyond them. In a way that we're able to balance a respect for the interdependent web of all of the people around us and the inherent worth that's found in all sentient creatures. It seems that technology is really limited only by our imagination, and the progress of technology has made it easier to lift people out of poverty and to connect people and to educate them. Star Trek is a sci-fi vision of the future where humanity has shed most of the social issues that burden us today, and where even in that time, humanity is constantly trying to improve itself on a personal, individual level and on a wide societal level. And much like other sci-fi, the state of human affairs in this fantasy is the result of the technological and scientific advancements that we've achieved. And also much like sci-fi, there is an advanced, technologically different version of humanity, which we use to make commentary about the life of current humans. However, unlike most other parts of the genre, Star Trek's future is bright and optimistic. It says, it posits that the collective power and accomplishments of humanity is a strong force for good that is worthy of celebration. Star Trek technically began in 1966 with this fellow, Gene Roddenberry. And although the original run of Star Trek in the TV series actually gained very little critical or audience recognition, it would then go on into syndication, and almost a decade later, the vision, that pure vision that Roddenberry had of the Enterprise crew inspired by Westerns would really start to gain popularity. This intrepid gang of space cowboys led by their cowboy leader would try to uphold their righteous values in the face of these nightmarish wildernesses that they would encounter in space. But these space cowboys have worldly humanist views, and there is no interpersonal conflict between the main characters. And having a society where all conflict comes externally is perhaps a very beautiful vision, but it doesn't necessarily make for particularly good television. And so Captain Kirk didn't really become a household name until over a decade later as those motion pictures were being released. And another two decades later, as TV episodes and TV theatrical movies were coming out concurrently for three different Star Trek spinoffs. You may have heard of them, the Star Trek The Next Generation, Voyager, and Deep Space Nine. These are programs that I personally grew up watching. And Roddenberry's influence is very, very strong over these spinoff projects. However, the creative flexibility was really allowed by the other writers and producers that were able to sort of get their hands on it later in Gene's life. And in my opinion, that's actually really what allowed Star Trek to truly become a compelling story of this optimistic future that fans genuinely found that they wanted to live in that universe. And if Gene Roddenberry is the god of Star Trek, then that means there must be angels and demons as well. And if we're going to interpret a piece of media, it's important to understand and keep in mind that the world of Star Trek is a product of several people's specific artistic visions. Roddenberry himself was a humanist, and he said that he was open to the idea of some sort of higher power, probably some sort of god that manifests as the collective humanity. But he was an ex-Baptist, and was very averse to the idea of organized religion and any mystical language. Ronald Moore, who was also a very big influencer on many sci-fi properties of the time, describes himself as a recovering Catholic, a story that I've heard from many UUs, who at one point was looking into various Eastern religions and has settled into a sort of agnosticism. Ronald Moore was a lot more eager to include specific religious commentary in Star Trek, and he did this by giving those specific religious or spiritual traits to some of the non-human characters, which would then allow the human characters to make commentary on. According to Moore, Roddenberry, quote, had felt very strongly that contemporary Earth religions would be gone by the 23rd century. In humanism, morals are derived from the personal and collective experiences of human life. And when those morals are fully realized, we might have a Star Trek-like society. Starfleet officers represent the sort of best of the best of this multi-species united federation of planets. The goal of this organization include peaceful diplomatic relations with their neighboring species, respect for the sovereignty and the inherent rights of any individual entity and civilizations that they come in contact with, a freedom of exploration, both intellectually, physically, and metaphysically. Do some of these values, or shall I say principles, sound familiar to you? I don't know of any UUs specifically that worked on Star Trek, but it's very clear that this aligns with a very humanist interpretation of our principles. The ideal moral agent is defined by these Starfleet characters and is also defined by its contrast to the alien races, where the writers have given off, since humanity is the best it can be, the negative traits that they may want to comment on in today's society are given to the alien species. And there are many single episodes that I could go on for a single sermon about, given that give life lessons relevant to our principles. But I'd like to just share some of the more general lessons that I've personally learned from Star Trek about what it means to be a good person. And because the principles tell us on some level how we should act on a personal, individual level, but also on an interpersonal level and on a societal level, and how we might want to structure that society. Starfleet, and that is to say most of the main characters who we're meant to empathize with in the show, are ideal, fully self-actualized individuals. The Starfleet officers, they always act for the greater good. They always remain objective. They don't act impulsively or selfishly. They are empathetic, but in full control of their emotions. They follow the chain of command, but they know when it's appropriate to break the rules. And from this, I gained what I consider to be the first lesson that I learned from Star Trek about how to be the path to self-actualization, which is a path that is defined through discipline and spiritual growth, one of our principles. And here, spiritual growth, I do not just mean the search for religious truth. I mean the growth of your personal spirit, to be free of material desires, to understand your own motivations and to truly understand your own psyche. To have spiritual discipline is the norm in the future of Star Trek. In this clip that I'd like to show you, a man who is from our time finds himself transported to the future, and he's about to find out that all of his money, and in fact all money, no longer exists.
I'm Captain Picard.
Excellent. Now maybe we'll be able to get some things straightened out.
We may indeed. Those comm panels are for official ship business.
Well, if they're so important, why don't they need an executive key?
Aboard a starship vessel, that is not necessary. We are all capable of exercising self-discipline now. You will refrain from using them.
I must contact my lawyer.
Your lawyer has been dead for centuries.
Yes, of course, I know that. But he was a full partner in a very important firm. Rest assured, that firm is still operating.
That's what all this is about. A lot has changed in the past 300 years. People are no longer obsessed with the accumulation of things. We've eliminated hunger, want, the need for possessions. We've grown out of our infancy.
You've got it all wrong. It has never been about possessions. It's about power.
Power to do what?
to control your life, your destiny.
That kind of control is an illusion.
Then what will happen to us? There's no trace of my money. My office is gone. What will I do? How will I live?
This is the 24th century. Material needs no longer exist.
Then what's the challenge?
The challenge, Mr. Offenhaus, is to improve yourself, to enrich yourself. Enjoy it.
Matt, don't play it again. Discipline, in the way that it's being talked about here, is about the ability to accept responsibility, and it's about being dedicated to truth, something which we can only do when we are truly committed to our own spiritual growth. Because spiritual growth cannot be done through the desire for power or possessions. It must be done through the betterment of oneself. The second lesson that I'd like to share with you are that all people, that is to say all sentient creatures, have inherent rights to explore the full limits of their existence. 60 years past when Star Trek first came out, racism is still a major societal injustice that we're dealing with. In a clip from the original series, Abraham Lincoln visits the future and uses an outdated racial slur. Lincoln expects them to be more socially equitable and expects them to be offended. However, humanity has evolved even to a point past that, where the idea that race is something which even could be judged is completely foreign. Take a look at this clip.
Bless me.
Excuse me, Captain Kirk.
Yes, sir.
Mr. Scott.
What a charming negress. Oh, forgive me, my dear. I know that in my time some use that term as a description of property.
But why should I object to that term, sir? You see, in our century, we've learned not to fear words.
May I present our communications officer, Lieutenant Uhura? The foolishness of my century had me apologizing where no offense was given.
We've each learned to be delighted with what we are.
Bless me.
I do love that line. We've all learned to be delighted with what we are. I think that's beautiful. Racism is posed as something that is completely ridiculous when it's performed by aliens, so that our human characters are able to present a more equitable viewpoint. I'd like to share another clip again from the original series.
It is obvious to the most simple-minded that Loki is of an inferior breed.
The obvious visual evidence, Commissioner, is that he is of the same breed as yourself.
Are you blind, Commander Spock? Look at me. Look at me.
You're black on one side and white on the other.
I am black on the right side.
I fail to see the significant difference.
Loki is white on the right side. All of his people are white on the right side.
Commissioner, perhaps the experience of my own planet Vulcan may set an example of some value to you. Vulcan was in danger of being destroyed by the same conditions and characteristics which threatened to destroy Charon. We were once a people like yourselves, wildly emotional, often committed to irrationally opposing points of view, leading, of course, to death and destruction.
It is
what they're trying to say here is that all sentient creatures have inherent rights in the world of Star Trek. There are many episodes that deal with encountering different forms of life that are very different than the kind that we might expect to find here on Earth. And we find that we must come to accept those differences and that those forms of life are just as valid and vibrant as our own. Indeed, each person has an inner universe that is just like ours. And it is righteous to defend those rights of all sentient creatures. In the following clip that I'm going to show you, they are pursuing a crystalline entity which has wiped out several space colonies worth of people.
I don't understand. Why are we pursuing the entity if not to destroy it?
We're not hunters, Doctor, nor is it our role to exact revenge.
What do you propose? We track it down, greet it warmly, and ask it if it would mind terribly not ravaging any more planets?
I don't deny that it may be necessary to fire on it, but I look on that as a last resort.
Why? Why not just kill it?
I want to try to communicate with it.
What?
We know from our own experience that our shields will protect us. So long as we are in no danger, I will make every effort to communicate.
To what end?
If we can determine what its needs are, we might find other sources to supply it.
Its needs are to slaughter people by the thousands. It is nothing but a giant killing machine.
Doctor, the sperm whale on Earth devours millions of cuttlefish as it roams the oceans. It is not evil, it is feeding. The same may be true of the entity.
That would be small comfort for those who have died to feed it. We're not talking about cuttlefish, we're talking about people.
I would argue that the crystalline entity has as much right to be here as we do.
Even in complex moral situations, there are certain inalienable rights that we cannot ignore. The desire for revenge does not outweigh the need to respect the right of every sentient creature to exist, and the need to communicate above all else, and violence as a last resort, is imperative in that pursuit. The third lesson that I want to communicate is that we must have compassion and seek equity in these interpersonal relationships. Because while rationality and stoicism are important, what we really need, we also need that human heart element. The emotionless logical Vulcans are allies to humans in Star Trek, but the half-human Spock's role, other than being a very fun character, is to demonstrate the pitfalls of a lack of compassion and the pitfalls of the use of pure logic. Equity and compassion what those mean in the Star Trek universe are protection of those who are vulnerable. In Star Trek Voyager's Prey, a member of a deadly species is being hunted down and seemingly for good reason. However, when the crew realize that the monster, in fact, is simply trying to retreat, they find that they're morally compelled to help it because it has no choice in that matter. And in one famous episode, Measure of a Man, Whoopi Goldberg explains how the removal of rights leads directly to injustice and oppression.
And now he's about to be ruled the property of Starfleet. That should increase his value.
In what way?
Well, consider that in the history of many worlds, there have always been disposable creatures. They do the dirty work. They do the work that no one else wants to do because it's too difficult or too hazardous. And an army of Data's all disposable. You don't have to think about their welfare. You don't think about how they feel. Whole generations of disposable people.
He's talking about slavery.
I think that's a little harsh.
I wonder if there were any real life events that may have been referring to. One of my favorite episodes, Tapestry, is about the importance of accepting ourselves. Captain Picard, the ethical diplomat of the Next Generation, tells us that passion and imagination are vital to who he is. And here he speaks about the interconnectedness of all events.
There are many parts of my youth that I'm not proud of. There were loose threads, untidy parts of me that I would like to remove. But when I pulled on one of those threads, it unraveled the tapestry of my life.
Each moment of our life may seem insignificant, and it may even be forgotten. But they all come up to the sum of who we are today. And even those memories that you can't recall contribute to who you are. Star Trek proposes that all life, is deeply interconnected in the same way. The United Federation of Planets is basically a UN in space. The medical supply, there are often scenes of medical supplies seen as cargo and other humanitarian missions that the Enterprise crew is seen going on. There's even a semi-infamous episode proposing that all sentient life is genetically connected in some way. Which brings me to my fourth lesson, that we must respect that interdependence through nonviolence. Nonviolence is a big ongoing theme throughout Star Trek. The Klingons basically embody all of the violent traits which are negative to our society that they'd like to comment on. Lieutenant Worf is also a wonderful character, one of my favorites, but as the token Klingon, when it's not an episode about him specifically, he is mainly used to make violent suggestions, which the more reasonable humans can reject. The conflict is said that can be resolved and should be resolved by diplomacy, by philosophical righteousness, and by cunning, rather than by force and by violence. Earlier, we saw that commitment to nonviolence, that firing on even a very dangerous entity would be a last resort. This clip is the opening to a classic episode, Mirror, Mirror, which I think speaks for itself, showing these not Buddhists interacting with the Star Trek crew.
We believe what you say, Captain Kirk, but our position has not altered. The Halcon Council cannot permit your Federation to mine dilithium crystals on our planet.
We have shown the Council historical proof that our missions are peaceful.
We accept that your Federation is benevolent at present. But the future is always in question. Our dilithium crystals represent awesome power. Wrongful use of that power, even to the extent of the taking of one life, would violate our history of total peace. To prevent that, we would die, Captain, as a race, if necessary.
I admire your ethics. And hope to prove ours.
Captain, you do have the might to force the crystals from us, of course.
But we won't. Consider that. Enterprise. Transporter room, energize.
In the world of Star Trek, it is righteous to acknowledge imbalances in power and to not abuse that power when you have it. Which once again brings me to my fifth lesson, that a fair and balanced community requires the removal of power imbalances. Themes of large-scale oppressions motivated by a combination of race, religion, and heritage are often presented in the Star Trek universe in the Cardassians. Another villain, a recurring villain, which when we contrast ourselves to them, we can say that power should not be abused and that it is our moral imperative to free people who are lower in power structures from exploitation. The Ferengi are basically people in Star Trek society, but their society is focused entirely on the accumulation of wealth. And what Star Trek has to say about this is that it naturally leads to systems of exploitation, that economic oppression can be eliminated by making resources readily accessible. One of Spock's best known lines, the needs of the many outweigh the needs of the few. Star Trek's answer to how to balance the inherent personal rights and the needs of the many is essentially the same answer that we see in the principles, freedom. The sixth lesson, fair and equal rights are ensured through democratic and fair representation. That we should have freedom from money and greed, that we should be free from societal classes and from monetary and material desires. We should be free to pursue trivial and intellectual ambitions. And to do this, we need to be able to trust in other people. And we do this, again, through my seventh lesson for us, the freedom of religious truth, one of our main principles. One point that Roddenberry certainly believed was that the freedom of religious truth was requires freedom from institutional religion. Humanity has a complex relationship with religion, which is represented in Star Trek by the Bajorans. The in this culture that produces fanatical individuals and generational blood feuds. And Star Trek says that an ideal human society should be free of these kind of institutional religious constraints. In Voyager's episode, Sacred Ground, this encapsulates a very humanist interpretation of religious freedom. Captain Janeway is a very scientifically minded individual, but has to go through a spiritual ritual to save one of her crewmen. The ritual is unique to every person, and every individual has to find their own way to enlightenment in this ritual. Conveniently, Captain Janeway does get a scientific answer for what the ritual has done for her, which is the dogma that she believes in. A more general free intellectual exploration is in the very last parting message of Star Trek The Next Generation, given by the nearly omnipotent Q.
For that one fraction of a second, you were open to options you had never considered. That is the exploration that awaits you. Not mapping stars and studying nebula, but charting the unknown possibilities of existence.
Star Trek's message is very clear, I think, about what humanity can be, about what the future has to offer us if we can achieve the best that we can be. Each Star Trek series was itself a product of its time, and it has its shortcomings, and it glorifies humanity for better or for worse. But Star Trek has a joy and an optimism which I think is lost in a lot of media, especially today. Most speculations on the future lean pessimistic, especially now, and so maybe it's even more important now than ever to remember that humanity can have a beautiful and vibrant cosmic destiny with peace, liberty, and justice for all. We're not done. We're not done. We have a benediction or the hymns first, isn't it? Our closing hymn, a familiar one, is Blue Boat Home. Those in the sanctuary, sit back, close your eyes, and listen quietly.
Stand by dry land, heart can say.
Devotion to Humanity by Michael Werner. Humanism is really about a passionate love affair. It is a love affair with life, not a mythical hereafter. Humanism is a love affair with a progressive vision of civilization in which each of us can add to our growing library of wisdom, our evolving knowledge of what there is and what is truly important. None of the great achievements in history would have been possible without a love of the adventure of learning and the adventure of creating a better life. Our great cultural achievements in science, art, music, literature, philosophy, history, psychology, and political thought all inform each other and have been born of that long humanist tradition. Humanism is a devotion to humanity and to the biosphere that humanity is a part of. It is our compassionate commitment to the best ideals that are supported by what experience, science, and civilization has taught us. Humanism is larger than any of us. We have a duty to continue humanism's evolving tradition, which has inspired countless individuals to make the world better. And at the same time, it motivates us to fill our lives with transcendent purpose for a meaningful, exuberant existence that makes life worth living. Namaste, amen, and blessed be.
Thank you, Alec Peck, for sharing your valuable time and insights with us this morning. It is sincerely appreciated, and we look forward to hearing from you again. If you're willing and able, we are going to have about a 10 to 15 minute Q&A following the service. Be aware this will be included on the video that is posted. We'll try with the walk around mic if you have any questions, and if not, we'll invite you up here up to the pulpit.
I do love talking about Star Trek.
Okay.
Thank you, Alec, for being perspective. It'd be fun to see how many people here were actually ever touched by the series.
Star Trek fans, a lot of you. Okay, great.
Okay. I'd also be interested in knowing who your favorite characters are, who you identified with most. I can start with that. I've only watched the original series. I haven't really had the chance to get into the newer series, but I've always loved Dr. McCoy. Is that his name? Dr. McCoy? Yeah, because he was always so, he's a man of science, but he was always so ironic. And he always struck me as the one who was drawn into arguments and debates. So I've always liked his personality. Someone else?
I think I had a fondness for Scotty. Merely, I feel sometimes like the only reason I get to hang out with other primates is that I pay my membership fees, the opposable thumb. And it's like you read things and you think you're getting smarter, and then all of a sudden there's this moment where no, there is no red wire, there is no dial, make it work anyway. And as a guy who was sitting there watching the machine not work, and the guy goes, oh, well, you're gonna have to climb into this hatch over here, kick this over here, lie like heck about how long this whole process. And when in doubt, throw a little bit of unobtainium number 4 into the exhaust sheet, you'll be fine. I liked knowledge, but there was always this time when the real world was sitting there waiting for me with a Jabba the Hutt smile. Yes, I'm going to cross genres here for a second. Going, little man wants to bring his technical knowledge into the real world. Oh, 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 oh. And I wanted to be the guy that says, aha, I've got the unobtainium number 4 in a widget. I always liked that. I had a question along the way. is that they would find a place for you technically to, if you were working in warp engineering and you wanted to go instead, there would be a spot on the spaceship for you. But what happens when all of a sudden you decide that you're going to move from engineering to, say, studying soil metallosis or how to bring the soil back? I didn't always get the impression that there'd be a place for you if you were to decide to make that midlife career change. But
do you mean a scientist in our world, or do you mean in Star Trek?
Maybe a little bit of both. It's like, of course, they had the budget, the big shiny ship, but how often do you think they allowed you to change majors, if
right,
you will?
Right. I didn't mention anything produced in the last decade because I didn't want to talk about anything negative. But there was. But I have enjoyed the recent animated series Star Trek Lower Decks, which is, as the name suggests, the main characters are not the people at the top of the chain of command in the spaceship. They are sort of lower in the chain of command, and it's about their day-to-day goings on, sort of like the one Next Generation episode titled Lower Decks, which is perhaps where they got the name and the idea. And in one of those episodes, we get to see one of the lower deck characters going through a personal crisis, not being able to decide which color jersey, which space jersey they want, if they want to be a doctor or they want to do engineering or they want to be in the command chain. And that episode and that series is mainly comedic, but I'd say that, that still counts as the Star Trek universe. And in there, all of the heads of the department are quite happy to take on the transfers from the other department and are not resentful when the character decides to move on to the next department. So that all went quite smoothly in canon in Star Trek. I've heard that even people who are in professional scientific fields will tend to have on average five jobs that are in completely unrelated fields of study. And that's probably in some ways that's becoming more common, but it's also becoming less practical. There was once a time when the same person could make discoveries contributing to physics and to biology and to chemistry. But nowadays, to contribute significantly into one of those fields requires all of your time and attention. And so, while there's certainly plenty of opportunity to collaborate with another related field, to get on the cutting edge of research might simply take too much time for a human brain and a human lifespan at this point in our technological development. It's said that Poincaré was the last human to know all of mathematics. Not only because he was a genius, but also because since then, the field of mathematics has exploded exponentially.
Having grown up with Star Trek, I have a favorite has to be the original series. What's your favorite and why?
My favorite series? And what was your favorite character again?
Oh, I didn't say. Probably Spock.
Probably Spock. Okay. I do have several favorite characters, but I'll give a special shout out to Lieutenant Barclay, some representation for the neurodivergent people. And he's a very fun character who, in the world of Star Trek, we get to see him overcome some of his struggles. And it's clear that in the Star Trek universe, all people are able to contribute to that society. And in terms of my favorite series, I would have to say The Next Generation, only because it's the one I'm most familiar with. There are some episodes of Voyager and Deep Space Nine that are very, that really resonated with me and stuck with me. Although it did take me a long time to come to terms with something that's perhaps heresy, but I actually think that I like Battlestar Galactica more than Star Trek. Yeah.
Anyone else? Anyone online, Adam?
Thank you.
Thanks for coming to my TED Talk.
I'm sorry, I just couldn't get a copy.